I'm just a man whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't make me shoot James Wood.
We're both sporting Tucker Carlson.
Okay, well, here we are. We're back again. Back pretty soon for us, at least.
Yeah.
It's been a short time since we watched Cats. Still haven't quite gotten over it, but you know, we suffer for our art. Yeah. So this is kind of a part one in a way.
Yeah.
Because the film that we're going to be watching today is kind of a companion piece to another film that we're going to be watching shortly. The movie we're watching today is Roland Emmerich's 2013's White House Down, starring a number of incredible players, but chief amongst them,
returning star, Blind Drunk Hall of Famer,
Mr. James Woods.
The one and only.
God bless him and all who sail in him. not really much to say on this one, to be honest.
Yeah.
But all I really wanted to say is the other movie that we're going to be watching shortly and comparing this one with, doing a little compare and contrast, is, of course, 2013's Antoine Fuqua directed Olympus Has Fallen, which, for those of you who know, is the exact same movie as this. This movie came out in June of 2013. In March of the same year, just a few short months before, Olympus Has Fallen was released in one of those wonderful bits of symmetry. It's like poetry at last.
Jar Jar is forgiven.
Yeah, Hollywood was able to produce not just one schlocky action movie in which the White House gets invaded by terrorists, but two within weeks of each other. I've definitely seen Olympus Has Fallen, but I don't precisely remember it other than the North Koreans invade the White House, which I'm already looking forward to. But that's for another day. Gerard Butler will have to wait.
Do they CG his
abs? Yeah, to make him look like a cat.
Yeah. Oh no.
They CG his Scottish accent out of the movie. So I want to lay some predictions down. I don't know if you want to do the same. This one obviously features Barack Obama. I think we're going to have a wishy-washy liberal Barack Obama having to learn how the real men do it.
Yeah, I think that's almost a given, yeah. Oh, he means well,
but he's limp-wristed and weak, and a big strong boy, Channing Tatum, has to come
along. James Woods.
James Woods has to come and teach him how to shoot a gun. He's going to reach around him and show.
He's going to give him a crash course in the school of hard knocks. Yeah. James Woods is going to assault the president. Yeah. I hope that happens.
Yeah, fingers crossed.
That's my prediction. James Woods is going to assault the president.
Well, similarly, I think that's... Yeah. And I think that Olympus Has Fallen is going to be the more Republican of the two movies, where you've got the vicious North Koreans being put down.
The damn commies.
Yeah, exactly, being put down by the Seagal-esque lead. Scotland's Seagal. So yeah, that's my prediction for the politics of the movies, but of course we're going to find out together. The only other thing I do want to say is, obviously Roland Emmerich, he's German, he's openly gay, so he's not quite the kind of directorial figure that we're used to dealing with.
Yeah, that's true.
So obviously it's a sort of an outside perspective perhaps that might be bleeding in. We shall see. All I do want to say is just point out just a snapshot of Roland Emmerich's directorial output. He went on, a 12-year tear is what I would call it.
The Emmerich tear.
Yeah. In 1992, Universal Soldier, starring Jean-Claude Van Damme and Dolph Lundgren. 2 years later, in 1994, he gives us Stargate, starring Kurt Russell and James Spader. The young James. Again, another 2 years later, 1996, he gives us Independence Day with Bill Pullman, Will Smith, Jeff Goldblum. I mean, the list goes on.
Jada, I love you. G.I. Jane 2, can't wait. Oh, wow!
Randy Quaid,
fuck.
As himself. As himself.
The guy who plays Data.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the scientist with the long hair. I can't remember his name.
Brent Spiner.
Mary McDonnell.
As the First Lady.
As the First Lady, yeah.
Incredible cast. Absolutely incredible cast.
There's that Labrador as well. He was pretty cool.
Yeah, I believe he won the Academy Award.
Yeah. For jumping away from explosions.
Yeah.
I think they have that at Crufts now, don't they?
In 1998, followed by the mega hit, everyone's favourite movie, Godzilla.
Certainly the best of the Godzilla movies.
Easily.
I don't think I've seen a Roland Emmerich movie since the excellent Godzilla 1998. I think that's the last one I watched.
Oh no, I can tell you with certainty that that is not the
case. Oh really? Oh, absolutely. Fucking hell.
He followed Godzilla up again another 2 years later with The Patriot. In which Mel Gibson single-handedly wins the Revolutionary War.
The most historically accurate and best film about the Revolutionary War.
Absolutely.
Heath Ledger, Mel Gibson.
Yeah. Tom Nuttall.
Yeah.
From the bartend. Jason Isaacs as the evil English Nazi.
Yeah.
Maybe at some point we should cover that on the channel.
The Patriot, that would be fun.
I don't know how much Mel Gibson I'd like to feature on the And then 4 years later, he bucked the trend here. He took 2 years off, I guess.
I suppose he'd earned the rest, really.
After dealing with Mel Gibson. He then followed that up with 2004's The Day After Tomorrow, the sort of precursor to a huge wave of disaster movies. So, like, obviously, I'm sure a lot of people are thinking, why are you talking about this? But
fuck you, this is our channel. We'll talk about whatever we like.
Yeah, you fucking lippy cunt. But yeah, like, it's important to remember, while not all of these movies are any good, these were big movies.
They were huge.
I know
yeah.
Godzilla was huge.
Independence Day was
a
massive,
huge kind of plot because of how
bad
kind
it
of
was.
Dreadful it was. But yeah, Independence Day obviously is huge even to this day.
Yeah.
Stargate obviously spawned this huge franchise.
Yeah.
And obviously the Universal Soldier franchise
continues
strong and healthy to this day. So yeah, I hope that gives you a little bit of a breakdown of just how big a deal this movie is. This is the kind of caliber we're dealing with. So I have hopes that this movie will at least be competently made.
Yeah.
You know, the guy made Independence Day, he knows what he's doing with big action set pieces, and has now got an incredible movie coming in a few short months. It's called Moonfall, right?
Right. Is it about the moon falling onto the earth?
Yes. I can't wait for this. This looks so good. This is such a throwback movie to like the period we were just talking about, like the core and things like that, where they had to dig down to the core and kill Delroy Lindo for having the temerity of being black in a disaster movie. The premise of this movie is a mysterious force knocks the moon from its orbit around Earth and sends it hurtling on a collision course with life as we know it. With mere weeks before impact, NASA executive and former astronaut Joe Fowler is convinced she has the key to saving us all. But only one astronaut from her past, Brian Harper, and conspiracy theorist K.C. Houseman believe her. These unlikely heroes will mount an impossible last-ditch mission into space, leaving behind everyone they love, only to find out that our moon is not what we think it is.
Wow. Okay, yeah, do you know what? I am down for that.
Yeah.
That sounds pretty good. Yeah. Shall we book our tickets
I've already
to go
done
to
it.
Multiplex?
I just pressed it buy now. It's done. We're locked in. We're ready. This is the movie that will wipe out mankind. Everyone goes against COVID just to watch this movie.
So, return to form.
Yeah, they don't make them like they used to.
Mm, except for Roland Emmerich.
So, I think that's pretty much all I've got to say.
Yeah, I've got nothing to say about White House Down, really, just Roland Emmerich in general. Yeah,
far too much to say, some might have.
Yeah.
It's already a 10 out of 10 for us because James Woods is in it, so we don't even really have to watch the movie at this point.
Thanks for watching.
Tune in next time.
Oh, yeah. Keep that money coming in.
So, yeah, I think we're going to have a more liberal White House. Mm. I think it's going to be like The West Wing meets Die Hard. That's right. I think we're going to get in this movie.
Wow.
Which honestly I cannot wait for.
Wow, I really hope so.
Yeah.
I mean, there's nothing like Die Hard to get you in the Christmas spirit.
Yeah. So, that's what I hope for. That's what I'm wishing for this Christmas. Let's find out. Yeah, without any further ado, let's get to it.
Oh, we love We
need Martin Sheen to come in and start like quoting the Bible and calling the Republicans hypocrites and then voting with them.
Yeah.
Because that's the American way.
Tell me we don't have the best job in the world.
It's the West Wing. The writer's credit came up as well when you said that name.
I love how this is just every Roland Emmerich movie ever.
Yep, so we've watched the movie. I suppose, short version, that was fucking incredible. That was absolute trash.
Yeah.
And the
glorious.
Best kind of trash imaginable. Yeah, absolutely fantastic.
10 out of 10, highly recommend. Go watch it now.
Watch it with your friends. It's incredible.
Yeah.
I suppose we'll do what we always do. We'll take you through the plot and we'll talk through some of our thoughts. Was my prediction right? Spoilers, I was more right than I could have possibly been. We'll get stuck into it. Let's do this. We open the movie, we're introduced very quickly to a young girl.
There is one thing I would say about the whole film, actually, is that it would have been a far better film if hers and Channing Tatum's roles had been reversed, so the daughter was the one die-hard in it for the White House, and he was
the 11-year-old girl was die-hard in slow motion.
That would have made it better.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. To save her... idiot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I think that's the thing, is cutting straight to it, this movie is very much a derivative work, shall we say, of Die Hard.
Yes.
But the fatal mistake that it makes is while the villain of the piece is every bit as hilarious and commanding, shall we say, as Alan Rickman's legendary turn as Hans Gruber in Die Hard, what the film fails to competently copy from Die Hard is there is no Bruce Willis as John McClane.
Yeah.
Like, McClane is such a great foil to Gruber, and he's just a great character in his own right.
Here
we go, it's John McClane. He's got the vest.
Look what I found. Merry Christmas.
Now I have a machine gun. Ho, ho, ho.
Whereas in this, unfortunately, we have John McClane in Die Hard. We have John Cale in this one, which is kind of McClane.
Yeah.
Like John McCale. And he basically just has no personality. His whole vibe is basically that he's like this sort of lovable lug. They try and set him up as like an everyman in the way that John McClane is set up, but John McClane is convincing, whereas this is just boring. Unfortunately, there's nothing to get to grips with on the character. He loves his daughter and he wants to do right by his president. Well,
especially as it's a Roland Emmerich movie, it makes it even more so because he's basically just Will Smith in Independence Day slash Matthew Broderick in Godzilla.
He's any other Roland Emmerich movie protagonist. The real main characters in this movie are actually his daughter, James Woods, and the president. They're the ones really doing stuff here. He's just John McClaning around them. He's like the thin gruel between the lobster tail and steak that is James Woods and Jamie Foxx as Barack Obama. We meet the president, we see that he's really cool and he loves Lincoln. He loves America and he loves knowing things about the presidency and stuff.
Yeah.
Which is a signifier in this movie of being a good person. Yeah. We are introduced to him in very West Wing fashion. We see that our cool prez, he likes to do the thing.
He loves to do the thing.
Where they swoop in on the helicopters by the Lincoln Memorial and all that.
It's very Emmerich.
Yeah, it's so West Wing. It's so Aaron Sorkin. We meet the team. We've got Ted. We've got Ted. We've got Maggie Gyllenhaal. Mm-hmm. We see the security all set up. There's snipers on the roof.
Yeah.
Nobody's getting into this place. Spoilers. Somebody does. Then after this, we meet John for the first time. He's outside the Speaker of the House's house, the house of the Speaker of the House. He's having a long and strange discussion with a squirrel. I believe it's named Clyde.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
He has a name for it.
We're under attack by squirrels, sir. They are organized and they have the numbers.
Little stinkers trying to get in the bird feeder again?
Yeah. Where, sir?
Hey, Roy.
John, I know this is not the most glamorous job in the world.
No, look, I appreciate it very much.
We meet the speaker, who we affectionately dub Bernie, played by Richard Jenkins, the always fantastic Richard Jenkins. Lots of West Wing ensues. He's a kind of oafish figure himself, in a way.
Yeah.
He's kind of, he kind of stumbles over and he's very normal and ordinary. And he gets a phone call and his ringtone is Spanish Flea. So he's like this kind of lovable Bernie-esque character.
But, you know, I think voters today want somebody cool.
No, come on, Mr. Speaker, I think you're pretty cool.
Is this Bernie? Is Richard Jenkins playing Bernie?
The president has a call scheduled with the speaker at 9:30.
Yeah, I should be up there for that, shouldn't I?
No, sir, you have to be here in case of a deadlock.
That's Joe Biden.
Yeah.
Hey, Jack, what?
Absolutely, Mr. Vice President. Red tie's the way to go.
Yeah, he is. That's Biden.
Yeah.
And they're doing the walk and talk from the West Wing. We're introduced to James Woods' character, head of the Secret Service. And we are immediately tipped off that something is very wrong
it's
with this
amazing.
Man. Every shot that we see of him is a gun, blood, violence, death.
It just seems
the
to get
president,
more and more
kill
sinister.
The president, kill the president.
Oh no. Oh. Do you reckon James Woods might be the baddie?
I find that very hard to believe.
That's what traitors do, they take their lapel flag off. It's like how cheaters take their wedding ring off.
We see him, he pulls his American flag lapel pin, he pulls that off, he puts it down. We see a picture of a young Marine with the dog tags, right, his son is obviously has been killed. And the reason that this is important, the reason the speaker is important, the reason that James Woods is important, is that Barack Obama, the dang Dem that he is, he's going to pull the troops out of the Middle East. And this is going to be a key part of the plot going forward. He's in discussions with the Russians and the Iranians, the Iranians, the Russians, etc.
Et al.
Et al. America demands peace. Clearly, that is its goal here. So we see that there's a hell of a lot of controversy around this bill. He's speaking with Bernie on the phone. He's like, listen, man, you got to back me on this, and we got to come together and make this work. We've got to heal the wounds and secure peace in the Middle East. And he's like, well, oh, and he's sat there in his mittens, and he's like, ooh, and he's all grumpy, and he's Bernie, and he keeps shouting. But he doesn't. No shouting, unfortunately, from Bernie in this. But that would be a great movie, Bernie. Bernie takes the. And there was a couple of points where we were really hoping that Bernie was Hulk out and take
that, that would have been well. Good.
Sadly, it wasn't to be. So yeah, we're in the White House now. We're in the Capitol building. It's all very January 6th.
Yes.
It all starts getting.
It is very January 6th. Yeah.
So we meet Joe Biden briefly.
Oh, yeah.
We see Joe Biden. He comes stumbling through the vice president
in a fugue state.
He's basically just confused all of the time. We get hints here that something's going on. We see this odd Conor McGregor with his IRA contacts. Is smuggling something in. He's disguised himself as a maintenance man, as like a janitor.
Yeah.
Something is afoot.
Because we both noticed it. It's like a West Wing walk and talk. And this guy just walks up and really obviously looks at it. And as soon as it happens, you're, like the film, it does this at every turn. Every time a villain is introduced, there's a massive clue that, this is a villain.
Is that fucking Conor McGregor?
You don't want him in the White House. Yeah. Fucking mess it, mate.
Yeah, little fucking Jack Russell shitting all over the place.
Tearing up all the cushions.
Punching all the old men. Watch out, James. If he offers you a drink, just take it. Kale goes to his ex-wife's house, his daughter's there. We find out that he missed her talent show thing and she was flag twirling and he missed it because he's a buffoon. Mm. But it's okay because he knows, as do we all, that the only way to an icy, despondent teenage heart is to get tickets for her to visit the White House.
Yeah.
Because apparently this girl is obsessed with the presidency and the White House. She knows everything about it. It's quite a strange character choice to make. It's kind of odd. The weird thing about it is it really doesn't go anywhere. There's like a couple of obvious like hooks that we really thought were gonna go places, and they kind of don't.
No.
Now, does anyone want to guess how old the White House is? Yes.
222 years old.
That's very accurate.
Does she know where all the secret tunnels on that island?
Yeah! Oh god, she is, isn't she?
So what brings you to the White House today?
Well, I want to see the tunnels where JFK snuck Marilyn Monroe in.
Unfortunately, no such tunnels exist. The hidden gold. They're going to find
them. And drop it on James Wood.
So she's going to be stuck in the White House when James Woods goes post. We then see the Kales. They're taking a tour, the tour guide, the guided tour of the White House, in which Greg from Succession shows them around the White House.
I have some leverage, but I'm reluctant to use it, you know, in case it sours things for us.
What leverage, Greg?
I don't want to bring anything up to you in a way that feels like horrible, but would it be bad for me to, like, mention those to you now?
Are you asking if you can blackmail me?
We have this brief scene where the president speaks to his wife. There's all these, like, comparisons made between him and Abraham Lincoln, and then the pièce de résistance is he literally has Abraham Lincoln's watch that his wife gave to him somehow on, like, the inauguration, and he, like, tucks it away in his pocket for later.
I don't know where she got Abraham Lincoln's watch from.
She pried it out of Lincoln's fucking skeletal
hand. She was looking for his gold, but she found his coffin instead.
Yeah. Lincoln's gold became a big plot point for us, and it's, again, one of the many mistakes the movie made by not including Lincoln's gold.
There's the East Wing, where you guys came in. There's the West Wing, which houses the Oval and Executive Offices of the President.
Yeah, and that's my favorite wing.
And we're about to enter the Residence, which is the big famous building in the middle that got blown up in Independence Day.
Oh my God, he just referenced that movie.
He just referenced Independence Day.
President Sawyer is one of those academics who never served a day in his life, and now he wants to tell the military how to run things.
Remind me again why we let these guys broadcast from my lawn.
Freedom of the press?
You know what? I knew it was something.
This is straight up the West. So yeah, every man Kale, he's trying to get a job. So he's already doing security for the Speaker of the House, but he wants to be on the presidential security detail because that's the prestigious one.
Plus, it'll make his daughter really impressed.
Exactly, impress his daughter. Yeah, exactly. Blah, blah, blah. And so he has the interview with Maggie Gyllenhaal's character, and it turns out they know each other. They like went to high school together, or college or something.
College,
it's
I think.
It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
It's there's a couple of instances of this where he just like one after the other. It's his ex-wife, then there's this other woman, and then Maggie Gyllenhaal, all of whom are like seem to be previous or current romantic possibilities.
Yeah.
It's very strange. None of them go anywhere.
No, one of them gets nuked on a plane.
It's really weird.
Hi, I'm Carol.
Hi, John. Carol?
Kale.
Oh my God, Carol Wilkes.
Actually, I'm Carol Finnerty now.
You're Deputy Special Agent Finnerty.
Oh, you're Janice Favor.
Is there anyone in the White House this guy hasn't fucked? Gonna meet the president and be like, oh, you're the president now? Basically, the whole point of this section is to drive home this kind of Stephen King-esque thing of how he's this everyman, he went to the School of Hard Knocks, but all these like academic types, they all fancy themselves, but he's got the experience, he lived it, he did multiple tours in Afghanistan,
he's
been a construction worker, he loves his daughter and he's got to provide.
He's a lumberjack and he's okay.
And as are we.
Yes.
And so there's this whole thing of like, you know, brains versus brawn, experience versus education.
Yeah.
But the joke's on them, because they're all about to be murdered violently.
Corporal Dawson is the nephew of the Speaker of the House. And when you were discharged a year ago, he got you a job with the Capitol Police?
Actually on his protection detail. Special Agent Todd keeps making those sounds. I'm gonna start looking at him.
He's gonna be one of the traitors.
Yeah, or he's gonna completely melt and not be able to do anything.
Yeah.
He's gonna be like, oh, what are we doing?
Or both.
And he's gonna
or
save him.
Yeah.
From fire or something. They're all sneering at him because he worked construction.
Shit.
But he's gonna show them.
Boy, he's a fucking idiot. So he's going to show all of them.
Yeah. We see James Woods, they throw a little birthday bash for him. It's his final day. Oh, he's one day away from retirement. So we know what that means, don't we, folks? And while this is happening, we're seeing like the mercenaries
sneaking around,
disguised as maintenance people and janitors, and they're all sneaking in. Yeah, we see James Woods. He's acting increasingly erratic and strange.
Which, to be fair, towards the beginning of the film, you can just pass that over as well. It's James Woods.
As not really being part of the performance. But we have this particular point where it becomes very, very clear. He obviously likes Maggie Gyllenhaal's character a lot, and so he orders her to go home and get some rest.
You go home and get some rest. That's an order.
Shortly after this, the daughter, she needs the toilet. Where's the toilet? Can I get a toilet? So she just heads off alone. So basically, this is where it all kicks off. She's gone to the toilet. John is unarmed, he's stuck with Greg from Succession, he's no fucking good to him. And we have the first truly explosive moment of the movie. It was the first sign that this was going to be really good. Conor McGregor detonates a fucking bomb in the Capitol building, like January 6th times 100.
Oh yeah.
Blasts a fucking hole in the Capitol building. It's fucking brilliant. Everything kind of starts happening at once. James Woods takes control of the situation. They lock down the White House. Everyone's in a state of panic and confusion, but James Woods takes command.
Get the president to the bunker.
Yes. Ted is like, whoa, what the hell are you doing? We need to leave. Like, we need to get away. And he's like, no, we need to secure him in the bunker. And that way, they can't do anything because you're just locked in the bunker and they'll have to leave. Ted is unconvinced, but he sticks with his prayers. And the killers emerge. There's a section where a Secret Service guy gets absolutely fucking ventilated with a nail gun. This is the point where we're fully introduced to the leader of the mercenary group, and he takes charge by nail gunning a Secret Service agent in the chest.
It's brilliant.
It's fantastic.
It is brilliant. You love to see it.
The mercenaries attack en masse. They literally do not miss a shot.
Yeah,
they are fully suppressed fucking Black Ops shit going in, just popping headshots left, right and centre. They just clear the board.
All these completely innocent people just getting absolutely fucking wrecked.
Yeah, so everyone just gets effortlessly wiped out at this point. We see the sniper security that we saw earlier on get absolutely wiped out, and the mercs just literally immediately take up the sniper positions and then just start wholesale shooting everyone around them. Start sniping all the security guards.
The parking attendant
gets domed.
Yeah.
it's fucking incredible.
It's brilliant.
We were cheering the whole time. Yeah. It was so fun. Like, we could not believe that it was happening. It was legitimately shocking.
Yeah.
This is incredible. Is brilliant. Fantastic moment while they're wiping out all the security people when the leader of the mercenaries caps this one guy. He falls down and there's this picture of George Washington looking down, and he's like, ha ha, and shoots George Washington in the head.
Oh, what a moment.
Hey!
Yeah, I've got to say, like, I find the violence in this movie, the way it's depicted, is very interesting, because the movie feels very much like a Roland Emmerich film.
Yeah.
It has that kind of chipper kind of happy-go-lucky attitude.
There's lots of quips.
Yeah.
All of them fall flat on their face.
Yes, they're terrible. Yeah. But the violence itself, when it happens,
it's not graphic, but it's just the casual, callous nature.
It's very stark and quick and to the point.
Yeah, like a perfect example of the violence, I would say, would be the guy we were talking about, the agent that sort of smirks.
Yeah.
Perfect example. It's like a character that's clearly being set up,
yeah.
A character that clearly has use in the story, that could clearly have some kind of moment in the movie, literally
just
turns around, door opens, and just gets gunned down.
Yeah, he just gets like shot multiple times in the torso, and it's just there's no doubt, he's just dead, and that's that, and that's it, and you never think of him ever again.
Yeah.
Is he dead already?
Yeah, I think that was... Yeah, that's just it, yeah. Again, it was another character where you think, oh, he's gonna...
Yeah.
He's part of it. And you said, oh, either he's gonna be a coward
and just completely have to be saved.
And instead he just gets shot and died immediately, just shot and killed.
Like within about five minutes of his introduction, he's shot and killed, and that goes nowhere.
The trouble is there's so many little things, and it's like, that was where your attention was supposed
to
be. The watch turns out to be important, but the tunnel's not so much.
Like having a knowledge of where things are in the White House when the place is locked down and it's full of mercenaries ends up having absolutely no bearing on the plot whatsoever. This guy having this like really obvious like teaching moment between him and Kale, it just goes nowhere. It's really like, obviously that's ultimately the point, but you could have really hammered the point home. Yeah. Much more, sure, it would have been heavy-handed, but it would have been like a character thing. Yeah. It would have had emotion behind it.
It would have been heavy-handed.
Just very overall general point that the movie made.
Yeah. Well, it would have been heavy-handed, but it's a fucking Roland Emmerich movie.
Exactly. It's a movie in which mercenaries invade the White House. Like a perfect example, just of what was just saying. Perfect example, like at this point, he came into the White House with his gun because he's on security.
Yeah.
He has the gun taken off him when he comes in, and it's put in like this case. There's this whole thing about the case. They put it in the case, they take it back, we see this whole room of all the guns that they store there and blah blah blah. And of course we were like, ah well, now we know that there is a gun in a case somewhere, so surely there's some reason why we went back there. Nope.
Yeah, it never comes up again.
And there's even more stuff that happens shortly afterwards that seems to add credence that it is going to, because we actually see them as they gun down the security people, they actually start collecting their guns.
Yes.
So it's like implied, oh, there's no firearms around, like there's nothing for him to pick up. But he'll know that, oh well, my gun is in there, I know where that is. No, never happens. He just picks up a gun off the floor. Even later on, right near the end of the film, there's still just guns
laying around.
Even though
we
saw them picking up the guns to stop. It's really strange. So at that point, we are introduced to the oddness of these mercs.
Mm.
So most of them are acting in this kind of military fashion, but there's this one particular guy who looks like a militia member.
Yes.
He looks like straight up January 6th. He's the White House down shaman. He comes in, he's always one-handing this little submachine. He's just spraying bullets everywhere. He's covered in tattoos, one of which is a kind of anarchy symbol, and we come to learn later on that he's a neo-Nazi. Again, the politics of this movie is very confused. He has this strange kind of subplot running with this right-wing political commentator, this kind of Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity-esque figure who he loves and he thinks is great, so he hangs around with him while he's holding everybody hostage, and there's a whole sort of plot that develops with him and that similarly as to basically everything goes nowhere.
Yeah, I remember thinking fairly early in the film, I said it, like, oh, he's going to turn on him because he likes Rush Limbaugh, but the mercenary leader is mean to Rush Limbaugh. Yeah, so I was... Yeah.
There seemed to be some trouble brewing.
Yeah, but instead of that, no. Nothing. It doesn't go anywhere.
So basically, at this point, James Woods leads the president and all the president's men. They all go into the bunker. They're getting ready to go into the bunker.
Down in the stairwell.
Yeah, they go down under the east wing, just where WikiLeaks said.
For your information, miss, it's the one room in the house that no one knows the location of.
WikiLeaks says it's under the east wing.
Who wants to see the bowling alley?
I told you I would eat you.
We're family.
I told you I would eat you up.
We're brothers. We're brothers. We're brothers.
And they go in, and James Woods very conspicuously hangs back. The door opens, and boom, James Woods strikes.
Like a snake.
Yeah.
Like a lightning snake.
Yeah, he opens up with his Beretta, and he goes to town. He guns everybody down. He basically headshots everyone. Ted is left dying against the wall, and Woods apologizes to him. Sorry, Ted. Bang, 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 blows his whole face apart.
I'm sorry, Ted.
Mine!
Consider this my resignation.
Thank you for your service, Ted.
And takes the president hostage and fully reveals himself as the leader of this mercenary attack on the White House. So, yes, James Woods has now fully taken control of the president, but the one man they didn't count on was Big John Cale.
It's always John, isn't it?
John!
John Matrix. John Gooday. Fuck, it's always John. And then there's Barry Rivers.
Yeah.
Barry's a shit name for an action hero. Which doesn't work.
Yeah. But, of course, they didn't count on Big John Cale. He comes bullying his way through the door.
Oh, yeah.
Spraying bullets. He snatches victory from the jaws of defeat. Gets the president out of there. Although, again, this is the part of the movie where suddenly everyone starts missing every shot. There's this transition that happens.
Yeah.
No one misses a single shot, including James Woods. And then within a scene, no one can hit John. Everyone opens up on him and no one can hit him. And he then can't miss a shot either. And then they both meet each other and start shooting each other, and neither one of them can hit each other. But as a test, like, I know we're being very negative. We're talking a lot about it's
we are, downside. Yeah.
You will see the clips of us just cheering along as we watch this.
Oh my god! What the fuck is this?
What is this? Yeah. It is important to stress that despite all of this, by sheer bullish tenacity, in many ways in perfect alignment with its hero, it manages, despite all of those failings, to be absolutely brilliant. Yes. Anyway, it's important to stress
it is.
That.
Yeah, yeah. I loved it.
It was amazing.
Yeah, I loved it.
It's
yeah.
well worth yeah. your time.
I mean, it's certainly better than fucking Cats. Yeah. I was hoping that it'll break out in song at one
point.
Yeah,
that would have been nice.
Yeah, it would have been nice.
Maybe it's for the credits. All the dead people get back up and start singing. Yeah, we start to see here, now that the president's escaped, we see that there's a little bit of tension between Emil, the head of the mercenaries, and James Woods. They're not quite on the level.
There seems
to be a difference of goal. And maybe they're not quite working together to the same ends. But they're two alpha dogs. button heads.
Yeah.
Cake? No, I don't want cake. I'm diabetic.
Do you think the diabetes is going to come back?
Yeah.
He's going to need insulin.
He's going to need insulin. The little girl's going to slip loads of sugar into his coffee or something.
Yeah, and he'll go into a fucking coma. We also meet this really weird, incongruous character who turns out to be a computer hacker who really like is such a like diversion away from the rest of the movie.
Completely unnecessary.
Totally superfluous.
Because the introduction of this character, you would think he was like the leader of the whole thing. Because he comes in and it's like this big entrance and all the others are like, oh, it's him. Yeah. It's like the munchkins are all whispering to each other. Do you know what I mean? It's all like, what's
this? It's quite strange, and he really doesn't do much and serves really very little purpose that couldn't have just been served by someone.
I mean, all he does is just be that hacker character from Die Hard.
Yes, like, he is.
So they have scenes where it's literally the framing, the lighting,
it's literally
Die Hard.
That scene from Die Hard.
The classical music, him like madly like taking it all in and
talking to himself.
Yeah, yeah. He's relishing like, the whole thing.
I believe he does the sports play stuff in Die Hard. He's like calling it out like it's a
football match or something.
And he's doing similar stuff here. Yep. It's like they copy and pasted the Die Hard script and then wrote around it. And they forgot to change that scene, so it just incongruously just is the same scene. It's super weird. We also see, of course, because, you know, the reason that he's escaped, you know, from the tour group and is shooting up all these people, he's gone to rescue the president, of course, as is his patriotic duty.
Oh, yeah.
But first and foremost, the reason he went off is because his daughter is still on the loose. She's now been separated and he doesn't know where she is. He doesn't even know if she's still alive. We come back to her. She witnesses a number of people just getting brutally murdered directly in front of her.
It's like there's a SWAT team, isn't there?
Yes.
And she sees them and you can see like the relief on her face. Like, I'll be all right.
She's going to go
and
out.
And they will just get fucking whacked. So she just runs off.
Yeah.
And then she gets to like the top of a staircase and it happens again. And it's like the fact that these people would be so traumatised and yet none of them are at all.
No.
They're just all very chipper about it.
Yeah, they're still cracking wise.
I have no visual on it. Switch dead, two, nothing more. 10-4. Still have them on. No.
Everywhere she goes, everyone's just shot to death. The sort of weird journalist kind of thing.
Yeah.
Where she just knows all this stuff.
Yeah.
And she's like, comes back again where she just pulls her phone out and just starts videoing everybody. She apparently has a YouTube channel.
Mm, she's a blogger.
Yeah, she's a video blogger.
A video blogger on the YouTube.
Yeah, as the president puts it. She starts videoing it and she like gets a whole bunch of the mercenaries' faces on camera. We see from the news that they just immediately assume that it's Muslim terrorists.
Yeah.
And so all through this, we clearly get the vibe that it's like, whatever it is they're asking for isn't really what they're after.
Does that remind you of any other film?
Kale is on the loose with the president. Kale's daughter is on the loose with her YouTube blogging. And much much Die Hard ensues. there was much rejoicing. Basically, at this point, a bunch of other cabinet ministers have all been captured. I think the Secretary of Defence gets his head blown off.
Yeah.
The Secretary for Homeland Security is someone who was in Rudy
with James Woods. That's right,
an incredible,
I can't believe that.
Incredible moment.
So he's the second actor to have a return on Blind Drunk. That's quite something.
Yeah. Maggie Gyllenhaal's character, she's like Secret Service something.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure exactly what her job title is.
Yeah, I don't
she's
think
in the,
anyone
in
involved
in
the film is.
Mr. Speaker, I'm General Caulfield.
It's
Colin Powell.
Sir, the stock market's collapsing.
Yes!
Fuck yeah. Her and the Speaker of the House go, they meet Lance Reddick, who's playing this kind of Colin Powell-esque general figure.
Mm.
And they go to this other bunker elsewhere, like away from the White House, and they get in touch with Joe Biden, who's on Air Force One, like flying around in the sky. He looks constantly confused and lost, like it's like FaceTiming your like great grandfather back in like 1890. He's like, he has no idea, like he doesn't understand what the plane is. Like he looks out the window and doesn't know where he is. Like the whole thing is quite sad, really. All he wants to do is stick a baseball card in the spokes of his bike so it sounds cool when he goes along, like they used to.
He's not dressed like it, but like I can only picture him wearing like a dressing gown and slippers. Yeah. Like, thing.
Yeah. Very, very Biden-esque figure.
Mm.
So there's a lot of confusion. They're not sure if the president is alive or dead. They don't know what's going on.
Yeah, he keeps talking about, you know, invoking
the 25th Amendment and institute himself as president, because obviously all these different ministers are all dead or they're captured.
There's certain things obviously that they want to do, but only the president can authorize that.
So they're in a bit of hot water. Shortly after this, we see the daughter again. She's videoing a bunch of these cabinet ministers that have been kidnapped and the racist neo-Nazi militia member. He's like just about to go inside when she gets like a big comically huge text message on her phone from her mum, which has like a fucking sheep sound effect or something.
Yeah.
Because it's weird, it's just after he calls them a bunch of sheeple.
Oh. He does as well, he actually uses come on, sheeple! Yeah. Oh my god. Fucking January the 6th, man.
Yeah, it's so funny watching this now. They're all chanting for Mike Pence. They're all chanting, they're all saying lock her up. They all want to see the emails. It's brilliant.
Let's go, Brandon.
Yeah, they're all shouting, let's go, Brandon. And so he hears this notification on her phone. She's like hiding behind a piano, like, which not only wouldn't hide her, but doesn't hide her.
No.
He just immediately spots her because she just sits there looking at him. So he comes chasing after her, and because he's like an evil villain, like they all are, they are all just like comically beating this child up at every opportunity they get.
It's like he's toying with her. He's like, come here, wherever you are. And he's got on the stash that he could have been twiddling as well.
And so basically she managed to lock herself in this room. She knows she's going to get caught. So she starts uploading the video to her YouTube blog. And so he just grabs her and slings her in with all the others, but she's uploaded that footage, so we come back to Kale and the president. We find out that they've been hiding in the elevator shaft. They've been die-harding it out.
They have been die-harding the fuck out of it.
They even start going through one of the little like vent things.
Yes, exactly. Like
John McClane. Yeah. They have this little back and forth, like chatting and joking. Becoming firm friends.
Oh yes.
Obviously, they need to make contact with the bunker people, with Bernie in the bunker. But he also needs to get a hold of his daughter. God damn it, he loves his daughter and he's gonna get her. We come back in the bunker and they finally get a message through into the White House. The hacker dude fixed the phone. Like the only other scene basically in the movie that he has. He puts him through to James Woods, and that's when they all finally realise that they have no idea what they're dealing with. They're dealing with James Woods. He's the man in charge, and he makes this kind of ridiculous demand. He wants like hundreds of millions of dollars brought in to the White House, or he's going to execute the president on the White House. But Gyllenhaal, she's like, well, I want proof you've got the president. And they're like, you give me the money, because obviously they've lost him and they're still trying to get. So the mercenary leader takes some of his guys and heads out. They're going to go and get this damn lovable buffoon John Kerry and everybody's favourite president, Barack Obama. And I think Gyllenhaal even says, like, you know, really, this is all for money?
Yeah,
James Woods, really? Is this what you're in it for?
Yeah.
And he's like, you shut up and money. Yeah, money. Yeah. It's clearly, it's obvious that there's more in it for him. This is more personal. It's to do with, you know, his son. We've heard this a few times in the movie by this point. You know, the president, like, shakes his hand and happy birthday and I'm sorry for your loss and all this shit. And everyone's like, you know, look, God damn it, John. You're not going to bring your son back. Stop with this foolishness. And he's like, you give me that money or I'll splatter the president's brains all over the Oval Office. It's clear that it's very personal for him in a way that it's not personal for the mercenaries. Unsurprisingly, it goes all sort of buddy cop with the president and John Cale.
It's imagine if Die Hard were a buddy cop movie.
Yeah,
so
well,
it wasn't just John McClane on his own.
If John and Al were together in the building. So we've got the president, who's this sort of liberal wishy-washy. He's this academic type. He's got his glasses. He needs to put his glasses on before he can take the gun. Basically, they realise that there's like this special phone that's kept in this like presidential room. It's this unmonitored line. So they hurry there through the elevator shaft. It gets all sort of buddy cop. They're making these kind of silly jokes. All the comedy, all the jokes, all fall flat.
Yeah, they're terrible.
Everything
they're really
that's
bad.
Supposed to be funny isn't funny.
Yeah.
And everything else is absolute grey and fucking gold. It's so weird. At this point, the president has lost one of his shoes.
He sacrifices his shoe.
Yeah, they're going to one of these like presidential suite rooms, and he goes to grab a second pair of like, you know, lace-up
Oxfords or whatever.
Dress shoes. And he fucking he picks them up, drops them.
I was just about to say as well. I was literally thinking as a pair of boots would probably be better for him. You know,
he reaches in and he grabs a pair of fucking Jordans. It's just incredible.
Get your hands off my Jordans!
And he starts lacing those bad boys up. But of course, they get in touch with Air Force One. One of John's like romantic potentials is on Air Force One.
She's having a little drink.
Yeah, she's having a drink, and it's hilarious. Hijinks on Air Force One. It's so funny. Very West Wing. So they get in touch with the vice president, and they get put through into like Bernie's bunker. Mm. Weekend at Bernie's bunker. So they're talking like, you know, the president's still alive, he's free, we need to try and get him out, they want to send the SEALs in, they're going to do this, that, and the other, blah, blah, blah. James Woods is in a bathroom somewhere, and he looks down and sees a newspaper headline about the president making calls, and suddenly remembers this phone and knows that that's where they're going to be. So he calls it in, and all the mercenaries start running there, and then he suddenly like starts... like his hands start like tightening up and he like collapses on the stairs, and we're obviously immediately we realise, oh my, like he's dying. Turns out he's got cancer, he's taking cancer medication and he's dying. So it's made even more clear that this is not about money. This is not about money. So the president and Cale are still in this presidential suite, and the mercenaries come bursting in. Cale starts blasting, dropping bodies. He starts having this like mano a mano fight with this gigantic, truly a bear of a man, who literally looks like Raoul Moat. the president has a run-in with another mercenary who appeared dead, and he tries to take his gun off him, and the guy grabs him and he starts stomping his head in with his Jordans. It's utterly bizarre. And so he comes running into the kitchen, and Cale's like getting overpowered by this giant dude, and he can't shoot because he can't see, so he has to put his glasses on. Cale like manages to slip out.
He's like, shoot him now. Shoot him now.
And then he gets
away. Now shoot him.
He's behind.
Very
you.
Funny.
It's very panto. And then the president just straight up fucking murks this guy. Just like full or oh, is this dude in the chest like 90 times?
Yep.
He murks this merc.
Yes.
To speak to the point that we were making as well about things seemingly being set up and then not being delivered. This is a perfect example here. So as they arrive in the presidential suite, there's this little conversation where, like, as they're trying to do this like buddy cop back and forth stuff with the president and Cale. The president's like, oh, you know, we need weapons and we need, you know, fight these people off, sort of thing. He's like, we should go to the kitchen and get weapons. And Cale's like, what the hell are you talking about? What weapons are you gonna get? And he's like,
we got knives and sharp knives.
And he's like, oh yeah, well, you can make me a sandwich then. What are you gonna do with a knife against these guys with machine guns? That's the point he's making. And so of course we then end up having a fight in the kitchen, right?
Close quarters.
And the president comes running in, and oh god, I can't shoot him. because he's stuck in the way. There's actually a point where the guy throws kale and you see a fucking knife block right there on the side. So you're like,
I know what's going to happen.
For the keen-eyed audience member, you're like, haha, there's going to be a funny little buddy cop bonding moment here where Kale manages only to save himself by getting another knife and stabbing the guy. Yeah. And it's going to be like, oh, well, the knife didn't look too bad, eh? Yeah. And he's like, oh, okay, maybe the president knows something. Oh, okay, fair enough kind of thing. And then he just ends up pushing the guy and the president just fucking sprays him full of bullets. And it was just like, wait, what? Well, then why did any of that happen? Yeah. Why did you have that dialogue then? Why did you have any of that? There were so many opportunities for legitimate, perhaps not the funniest jokes,
but appropriate jokes
that actually reference events as they are playing out.
A joke that has, you know, a setup and a payoff.
Yeah,
but instead, you get, punchline is the exact right way. It's like someone starts a joke
and then
just tells you the punchline to a completely different joke. And so you're sat there like, what? Yeah. And you've heard both of these jokes before, so you know what they've done wrong. And you're like, how did you get that wrong? You were telling the joke. How did you get it wrong?
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
To cross the road.
To get to the other side. Jokes. Do you see?
They're easy. Yeah, it's quite rubbish. Yeah. So, oh my god.
Yes, we can.
So the president mans up, they're kind of fully bonded now, they've killed for each other.
Yeah.
They're like Spartan warriors, they both have. That's when I think we go back to the hacker and it's just full Die Hard.
Yeah, with the classical music and all.
It's crazy. This is just literally Die Hard.
Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah, it is.
Nerd in the glasses with the classical music playing. When I said it was going to be the West Wing and Die Hard, I didn't think it was going to be literally just scenes from the West Wing cut with scenes from Die Hard. We go back to Air Force One and the bunker, because at this point, obviously, they were talking to them and they hear gunshots and all that. Look, we can't count on the president out of this. We can't count on the president surviving. We can't assume that he's still alive. We need to invoke the 25th Amendment and swear in the vice president. He's the only man for the job. The guy is, literally stumbling around in his dressing gown at this point. He has fucking no idea what's going on.
The president is behind enemy lines and compromised. Now I'm calling the cabinet together to invoke the 25th.
You want to remove the president from power, sir?
I don't want to do anything.
I want to go home and eat my lunch. I'm tired. I don't want to talk to you anymore.
It really is Joe Biden.
It's absolutely tragic.
Yeah, it is. It's tragic.
So they swear him in. Basically, Kale and the president, they hide. It's like a dumb waiter shaft.
Yeah.
And basically, by the time the mercenary boss and James Woods arrives, they've gone. And so they're like, damn it, they killed our guys and they've gotten away. We would have gotten away with it if it wasn't for the meddling president and his secret serviceman. If it wasn't for the meddling president of the United States
and the secret service.
And so, as they're sneaking down, and I think it might even be the fucking Jordans, that he's wearing slips.
He
has to grab the cable.
That's
and James
it.
Woods
yeah,
hears
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
and he comes running back and they start blasting at each other.
The president is in between them and they're blasting at each other. It's important to remember, James Woods has specifically said over and over again, he needs him alive. And then you've got Kale, who's supposed to be trying to keep him alive, and so he's in between them.
And they're both
shooting at each other.
In a fucking tin can. So he goes stumbling backwards. We were hoping it was going to be like a Matrix bit.
Yeah.
He was going to smash it, but they slide down into the, and they end up down in the bottom in the bowels of the presidential palace back before the Revolutionary War. And they end up basically in the fucking Lincoln tunnels, and they go looking for Lincoln's wall.
Can you get to the basement?
There's a series of tunnels.
JFK used them to sneak Marilyn in.
The daughter is definitely using the tunnels.
Yeah, the Lincoln gold is definitely going down. I think that's what they're after. They want to steal George Washington's wooden tomb.
Shit! They're gone.
I love to get angry in kitchens. They're the best place for it.
Especially when it's someone else's kitchen.
Yeah, there's so many pots and pans to knock on the floor. make great noises. She's like guiding them through the, like, oh, what's the code for this door? And she's like, oh, it's 3-5, and they're like, yeah, and going swimming. Basically, there's like this escape tunnel for the president. They're getting chased by the mercs, and we've already seen the hacker has gone this way. This is the way the hacker went, and he's down in the computers that are underneath the White House. It's really weird. It never really makes any sense. No. But he's rigged the whole place to blow. He's rigged the door up with an explosive so they can't get through. So the one escape route that they had is now cut off. And so they end up going into the garages. They manage to get into the heavily armored presidential limousine, also known as the Beast. And they come smashing out onto the presidential
lawn. I have
to
say, at this point, what happens now is possibly the most amazing moment in cinema history.
Truly incredible moment. A whole bunch of different things align here. We just get these incredible moments in the latter half of this movie. There's so many of them. So they're basically doing donuts on the presidential lawn.
Yeah, around the big fountain.
Around this huge fountain, while mercenaries chase after them in big SUVs with fucking miniguns attached to the top, blasting round after round.
Can't touch the Beast, though.
No, into the Beast. They're spinning round and round. Press the world's press are arrayed outside filming with their mouths open. Yeah. By this point, the ex-wife has turned up. She's outside, what the hell is going on? Bullets flying everywhere. Everyone's screaming. Bernie's watching it on the fucking monitor, like, what the fuck is this shit? He don't know what's real anymore. Game, set, match,
motherfucker.
And so, because the Beast can't, like, smash its way out through the big gates and the walls and everything, they need to find a way to try and blow a hole in the gate. So they manage to get in touch with the generals in there, and a tank comes bursting in through one of the walls and starts firing at the fucking RPG guys on the roof of the White House. The RPG guys are firing at them. They manage to blow the fucking wheels off the tank so that they put a hole in the gate, but it's blocked.
Up,
so they have to keep going round and round. The president remembers, wait a minute, there's supposed to be like a weapons locker inside the fucking limousine. So he jumps into the back of the fucking limo, pulls this big fucking crate out, and there's this big like chrome RPG in the back. I have no idea why it looks like that. And
it's really strange looking because it's just chrome belt.
I don't know if it's a race thing. I have no idea what the decision making thoughts was in that. So he pulls it out, and the president's like doing a fucking Three Stooges routine, turning around and bonking him on the head with a fucking rocket propelled grenade.
I know you're into peace and all that, you gotta stick that thing out there and go to work.
Damn right.
President?
Oh my god, that's President Sawyer.
He has a rocket launcher.
It's utterly bizarre. He's like, Mr. President, it's time to go to work. And he's like, hell yeah, opens the fucking side window. Barack Obama is now hanging out of this fucking bulletproof limo with a fucking RPG. He fucking shoots it at this gate, blows the whole fucking thing to pieces. And they're like, yeah, yeehaw. They start spinning around and around. The fucking mercs are all driving around fucking still firing fucking miniguns everywhere. But then, oh no, they've seen on TV the little girl's footage got uploaded.
Yeah.
And all the news are like, oh, this brave and beautiful patriotic girl. They put her fucking name and everything on there.
Yeah.
They put a fucking picture up, like fucking dumbasses. So now all the fucking mercs inside, they all know that it was her that fucking just outed them all to the world. So no one thinks it's Al Qaeda or whatever anymore. They all know their faces.
We are sure that we will no doubt learn the names of the men who are holding the White House hostage. These men are clearly not Al Qaeda.
White people can't be Muslims. We see the generals like IDing all of them because of these pictures. So they fucking drag her out onto the fucking balcony. The neo-Nazi sticks a fucking gun to her head. So he comes fucking slinging past, looks up and sees his fucking daughter with a fucking submachine gun pressed to her fucking temple. And he's like, oh my god, what the fuck am I gonna do? He's not paying attention, he swerves off the path. They fucking hit the Beast with a fucking RPG. Boom. Flips the fucking car, goes through a fucking tree, through a fence, and into a fucking swimming pool. They sink down, they're all fucking like drowning inside this pool. James Woods is furious because he's like telling the mercs not to destroy the car, don't kill the president.
Yeah.
And they're basically just like, oh fuck. fuck this, kill them both. So we're really coming to a head now. They all arrive on the scene at the same time, and the president's like, hey, look, stay behind me, put me at gunpoint, because they'll kill you, you know, they want me alive. So Kale's like got a gun to the president, he's hiding behind him. And so James Woods is like, come on, son, you know, I've been in your position. You're doing this to save him, you ain't gonna kill the president. And he's like, I'm on the edge, man.
I'm a mad fucker
with a gun.
You know, I got this gun.
And the mercenaries are all there, all fucking lined up with guns and everything. But at this point, Kale has taken a chest rig off of mercenary that he's killed, and he's got fucking grenades all over him. So he pulls a grenade and he gives it to the president. So the president, like, behind him while he's got the gun, pulls a fucking grenade out, pulls the pin, just full on bang. And he's like, fuck you, motherfucker. Throws the fucking grenade at James Woods, like, right on him. They all fucking go jumping back. The whole thing fucking explodes. They run into this, like, fucking pool house or whatever. This, like, shed next to the pool. Inexplicably full of fucking explosive gas canisters. And this fucking merc on the fucking minigun just opens up and just blows the whole fucking thing to pieces. So everybody outside and James Woods and everything, they're all watching, and they see the president and Kale jump into this shed. So for all the world, the president is dead. Kale and the president are dead. Obviously, we know better than that. It takes more than that to keep a good president down.
Just and look so, at Donald Trump.
Yeah. Where we go, well, we go all. Oh, man.
Michael Jackson's here. I've seen him. He's in disguise.
Yeah. There's actually a whole point in this with the military-industrial complex where the president basically blames all of it on the deep state.
Yeah.
It sounds so much like QAnon stuff. It's so funny. So, yeah, they've been blown up, and it looks like the president is dead. That's where they hurry in. They swear in the vice president, thinking, you know, that he's dead for sure. They get in touch with James Woods again, and Maggie Gyllenhaal has this great idea that, hey, if this is all personal for him, we should get his wife in to talk him down. And in one of the
MVP.
Absolute best moments of the movie, they put the wife on the phone, and she's like, what the hell are you doing? Why are you doing this? And he's like, listen, okay, I love you and I'm sorry, but I have to do this for our son. They have to play, they have to suffer for what they did. That's why I'm doing this. And she's like, really? You're doing all this? You're doing this?
Yeah, doing this
for our son? And it's like, you know, oh man, heavy hitting. And she's like, well, if this is for our son, bury these motherfuckers alive. Fucking do it. Yeah. And they're like dragging her away. And she's like, fucking kill them all.
What I love as well, like,
so good.
After she's been dragged away, Maggie Gyllenhaal is like, she says to James Wood, if you don't fucking pay, I'm going to make sure she fucking rots in jail or whatever. And I'm just, I remember, so it's like, for what?
Yeah.
She hasn't committed a crime. Yeah. Especially in, you know, America, where
freedom of speech
and all of that.
Well, she said herself earlier on in the movie.
She's literally just like, fuck him, let him have it. It's brilliant.
Yep,
she's the best character in the whole
absolutely.
Film.
You're
doing this for Kevin?
I swear to God.
Then you do whatever it takes. You make them pay for what they did to our boy.
What the hell are you doing?
Yes!
Yes, queen!
Walker, you stop this, or I'm gonna make sure she spends the rest of her life in a federal prison.
For what?
Because that's the thing as well, like, talking about the weird politics of it all. Like, how she speaks up for the freedom of speech of, like, some right-wing fascist apologist who's, like, the number one fucking fan in the movie as a neo-Nazi with a machine. And then, like, here, we have this bit where it's like, oh, suddenly now we should just lock people up for 50 years in prison because they didn't help me get their husband shot.
Because they didn't do my job for me, which also involved having her last remaining family member get murdered.
Yeah. And then obviously we also have the bit with the president where it's like you'd think that he's like against the war or something like that, where he's sort of like, you know, we need to get the troops out, we need to do all this stuff. But there's a part where he literally says, hey, we don't need the troops there and missiles there, we can drone strike them from anywhere.
Yeah.
And it's like, wait, so what is the, what? The politics is such a
nebulous.
Everyone is kind of all political persuasions at once. It's like peak liberalism.
It really is, it's like the film has no understanding that there are different political ideologies and persuasions that kind of compete with one another.
Yeah, you just pay lip service to like freedom and peace and democracy, and then when the chips are down, they're just absolutely
they're for sale.
They're for sale, and like at best they're just completely indistinguishable ritual from Republicans and fascists.
Yeah.
Yeah, so all of that fails. Lance Reddick's character is like, Maggie Gyllenhaal, you're fucking shit. Everything you've ever done is fucking worthless. Get the fuck away from me. Like,
fuck getting a bollocking from Lance Reddick as well.
Where's my
I got 100 people in here. Somebody tell me something.
I think you look really nice in that uniform.
You're done.
Basically, she still thinks that she should be involved in this, even though she's fucked everything up to this point. And so basically, she goes to this guy who looks shockingly enough like Matt Gaetz. It was quite distracting.
So no, Maggie, run away!
Yeah, run! And she's like, hey, look, there's some kind of suspicious shit going on here. Like, how the hell did he manage to get all of these guys together? How did he get these mercenaries involved here without anybody finding out? Like, what the hell's going on? But look, I can't do this anymore because I've been overruled. I've been thrown aside. I've been jagged into the scrap heap.
Down here in this shit.
Who am I? A little man who spent 27 years of his life as a cop trying to put big shots like you away. 27 years in the filth and the dirt of the street, and there ain't no music down there. You watch the people in the streets killing, raping each other, pumping dope through their veins, while big men like you sit in the fancy penthouses and at the poor slob's rotten hell.
So she's like, oh, you can do this, you still have access. You need to find out, like, what's going on, the secret back channel communications, what's going on? And he's sort of like, oh, conflicted. Matt Gaetz is very conflicted.
That's
and
true.
For very good reason. So the vice president, who's now the president, sort of. It's weird. There's a lot of presidents in this movie.
Yes.
The pokey evolution of the president is very strange. The president orders a helicopter attack because what they don't know and what we know is that the terrorists have javelin missile launchers, which are like surface-to-air missile launchers, which is actually, it's exactly the same as Die Hard, when we see them setting up the big like anti-tank fucking guns and they send the big fucking SWAT team
and they just blast it to pieces, it's literally
exactly the same thing. So basically Kale managed to get back in touch with them and he's like, hey, what the hell are you doing? And they're like, we're sending in the choppers and we're gonna fuck these guys up. And he's like, no, they have javelins. And Lance Reddick's like, oh, I don't think they do, actually.
Yeah,
I think you're wrong. I choose to believe according to our intel. Yeah, and it's like, but
he's there.
It makes no sense whatsoever. It's just that classic dismissive thing that they have to do for the protagonist to have been right all along about these Washington bureaucrats. And so the helicopters come storming in. One of them like almost instantly gets fucking taken out with a javelin. They start like firing onto the roof. The mercenaries are getting taken out as well, but they're just fucking blasting these rockets into them. And the helicopters eventually go down. But Kale, he comes charging up. He needs to get onto the roof because, you know, oh my god, the helicopters are gonna get taken down. So he comes charging out. And then we have like a literal exact play-for-play fucking recreation almost of the bit from Die Hard where agents Johnson and Johnson are fucking shooting at him on the street thinking he's one of them. They start shooting at him with the fucking cannons on the side of the fucking helicopters and he's like running around and flying about, and so he starts fighting with the leader of the mercenaries, but the guy managed to get the javelin shot off and he takes out the last of the special forces guys as they're like rappelling down. The helicopter goes fucking flying and it crashes like backwards through the roof.
It comes through
the ceiling where all the hostages are,
God.
And it like nearly skewers Greg from Succession with the fucking tail of his
It's supposed to be really funny because he's shrieking, because he's literally that far away,
he's moments away from the void,
brutally killed. I think his reaction was perfectly valid.
He's moments, seconds away from throwing his arms wide and embracing the void, but he's like this foppish, limp-wristed milksop.
Yeah.
And so it's like hilarious.
He's the liberal ideal.
Yes, he's the future leftist
one. He's an Antifa super soldier.
That's the death pit, Greg. Take a look.
I mean, I feel like I might not like it in the death pit.
And so Kale gets literally suplexed through the roof of the White House.
Yeah, well, it's like a full, it's not even like when you say a suplex, because obviously you think of like, you know, like a belly to belly suplex, it's an actual like British bulldog style. Like, I'm surprised he didn't hold him and like raise him a few times.
That's the last ride through. Like, it's so funny.
It is amazing.
Yeah, and then he starts like mug into the crowd, his leg drops through and lands on it.
Oh my god.
They go through the roof of this like greenhouse on the side of the White House. There's the White House and the greenhouse. And so they start fighting each other, and they're like slinging each other about and kicking each other in the head. Real roughhousing.
Yeah.
Not nice to see.
No. Anyway. I'd say it went a little further than just horseplay.
Yeah.
Frankly.
Yeah.
And I was very upset by Mr. Emmerich.
Yeah.
There's no need for that kind of violence in your film about mercenaries attacking the White House.
Invading the White House. So yeah, basically Kale and the Merc leader are fighting each other, and one of the other Mercs comes running in, so Kale has to dive through a window. Yeah.
The amount of times this guy literally just hurls himself through fucking glass is unreal. Yeah. Not a scratch. No, like, okay, he's got a few little cuts. Yeah, yeah, but it's like...
Well, he jumps through the window, smashes through the window, and then drops all the way down to the ground. Boom, into like a fucking hedge.
Yeah.
And he's already off and running, like, seconds later.
But so he was in Afghanistan.
Yeah.
But they train you for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's hotted it off after his smash through the fucking glass, and he's run away, and... mercenary leader finds like an envelope left on the ground and he picks it up and he's all like
it says John Kale
and he opens it up and it's the tickets for the tour of the White House, which doesn't really make sense because surely they'd have taken those away when
it's really weird.
I don't know how you think tickets work, but
I really don't understand how it's super weird.
So now he knows,
and now he just knows. The kid
is his kid. I don't know how he knows that from the tickets. I guess it had their names on.
Yeah, John Kale. So now he knows that it's John Kale and Emily
Kale. Of course,
So now she gets taken double hostage. Yeah. She was already a hostage. Now she gets taken double hostage.
Oh, yeah. Well, he goes in there, doesn't he? Yeah. You've got Rush Limbaugh sat there with little fucking sycophantic. Porn stash written out. Fucking sucking him off, telling him how brilliant he is. And your man, the fucking mercenary leader, comes storming in. He's all fucking, right, that little bastard. Bring it over. And fucking Rush Limbaugh basically stands up to him.
No.
And it's like...
This is where I draw the line.
It's amazing. It's like, what I find so funny is obviously this guy, he's this right-wing pundit. And throughout the film, he's obviously terrified. Yeah. Which is fair. But the whole sort of point of the character, at least I thought it was... It's having a little dig at right-wing pundits, isn't it? It's like, you're all the fucking big man until something actually happens, and then you just cry and do nothing.
And obviously, having a dig at Fox News, basically.
Yeah, pretty much, which is great. You should have a dig at Fox News. You should have a dig at these people. But then...
Yes, the real point kind of emerges. The very West Wing point comes out of all of this.
He stands up. And he's like, Rush Limbaugh stands up.
Yeah.
He literally says to the guy, this fucking hulking fucking
maniac. With 20 different ways to kill you, just visible. Yeah.
Fucking Blackbeard, just right there. Yeah. And he's like, if you want to get to her, you'll have to go through me. And the guy laughs at him, the mercenary laughs at him, which obviously, because it's like, you could have probably chosen like a better way of putting that.
Yeah, Greg from Succession is more convincing than you are. Fuck me.
And so the guy's just like, oh, I'll have to go through you. Oh, okay. And he just fucking kneecaps him. Shoots him in the fucking knee, bang, and fucking obviously drags the girl away. Yes. But Rush Limbaugh standing up for the little girl, firstly, it undoes the whole sort of jokey aspect of that character. Secondly, people like Rush Limbaugh and these fucking shock jock dickheads would melt at the first sign of violence, and there is absolutely no fucking way on this earth that a single right-wing pundit would ever stand up for someone else, even if it was a little girl.
Yeah.
No way. Absolutely. Well,
I think it's very important to remember that it's like this guy, we get very little detail on him, but he's obviously a stand-in for a number of right-wing figures. He would be joining the terrorists.
Exactly.
He
was calling for it.
Support this. And he would join them.
He'd be reporting from inside there, doing interviews with them and trying to fucking make them appear as good guys. He'd be trying to lionise them.
Yeah.
Like, imagine Alex Jones being, you know what I mean? Yeah. What he'd be doing. Yeah. What he did do.
I think the other side of it, like, because there's that side of it, obviously, but I think in terms of why it's him in this scene that does it, is this very liberal version of, see, when the extremists come,
yeah,
us moderates,
yeah,
we come together.
Yeah. He's not your enemy.
Yeah, exactly.
This man who calls for this thing to happen every day, he's not your enemy. Yeah. It's the one who actually listens to him and does it. It's this really nebulous concept that I really can't get my head around.
He's a good guy, really. See, he stood up for the kid. Mm. I mean, you can't be that bad, can he? Eh? See, the left and the right, they can come together to fight against the extremists. The Nazis are actually good guys. And yeah, it's just this super West Wing version of just like, oh, Republicans aren't just like vacuous creatures who believe in nothing and who have like systematically demonstrated that via their destruction of your country. And you're just going to sit there and try and make this like moral equivalence between them and yourself. You want to compare them to you. You want to draw some parallel with them.
It's funny that.
So
it's
bizarre.
It's funny they should do that.
Yeah, that you would want to do that. And that's what you see with the Democrats and New Labour. Their understanding of their enemy is so childlike that it's just no wonder that they are so effortlessly
defeated. Oh, they're just people just like me.
Yeah.
No, they're not.
Cunts.
Career cunts.
Yeah, career cunts. And you look at the state of the world as it is, and it's like, it's because what choice do we have? We have a choice between Rush Limbaugh and some fucking weak-willed idiot.
Who will just allow Rush Limbaugh
who basically just wants to let them do whatever they want to impress them.
To show how
them.
Smart they are.
Yeah, to impress them.
Yeah.
And to build bridges. Yeah. Because it's like, oh no, he isn't like a fucking racist inciting violence to kill this black president. No, he has principles. We can disagree and whatever happened to civility and politics. It's like, motherfucker, like, we're talking about January 6th and all that shit and comparing to that. It's like, guys... Fuck me.
Yeah, I think, this film, its attitude, it's certainly its political bent, if you could call it, say it had one, is so indicative of this world we live in, where it's like, there's liberalism, and then there's fascism, and that's all there is, and anyone who stands up to the fascist is, that's very uncouth.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, no, take this one away and kill it.
Yeah. It is something that this movie bears out even more once we get to the reveals at the end of the movie. So, at this point, we have an absolutely phenomenal sequence. So, like I say, the vice president gets sworn in and he gets given, like, the launch codes. We have all this stuff play out, you know, he's swearing his hand on the Bible. I'll call him the vice president just for sake of easy understanding.
Yeah.
The vice president is on Air Force One. We've had all of this play out. The helicopter attack has failed. And we see the hacker, he hacks into NORAD and he accesses the missile launch systems. And... he launches a missile. We see it come flying up.
Oh my god,
Ohio.
The fucking other farmer on his tractor.
Oh my god!
Yeah, when I saw that farmer and the missile guy, I just thought we're watching Threads now. Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
So the missile comes flying through the air and we see fucking Air Force One going along with the vice president, who's now the president, and the fucking missile just instantly slams into the fucking Air Force One.
Where are they going to nuke Air Force One?
I repeat, this is an emergency.
They're going to nuke the president.
Oh, yeah. Sir, we're under attack.
What the fuck? Oh my god, what the fuck? Absolutely decimates it, just completely
so
annihilates everyone's life.
Again, this is what I'm talking about, like with the tone of the film and everything, the way they
it's so
like,
weird.
Out of nowhere,
they're quipping like 5 minutes ago, and then like 140 people get
you
blasted
see this
plane, out
and the
of
only,
the sky.
Like the last time you've really seen the people on it, other than just in the sort of video calls between the vice president and the military bunker, is the woman who was clearly a romantic interest for Kale at the beginning. She pours herself a vodka or whatever.
Yeah.
He's all like, oh. And there's these two guys looking at her all like disapproving.
Yeah,
and she's like,
really
I've had a very long day. Oh. And then goes to drink, and there's like a bit of turbulence.
And she gets the phone call.
Oh, she, yeah, yeah. And she starts and spilling it. And it's like, so that's it. You see this like
again, it's supposed to be funny.
Yeah, it's not.
It's not. It's not any funnier if you actually watch it, like, than just listening to us describe it. It's really not funny. And then it's just fucking bang, like, oh, these people having their funny little time. Yeah, they're all dead.
They just get fucking smashed horrifically, like, yeah. This guy is so fucked.
Ain't no Harrison Ford to save him.
No, get off my plane. So Air Force One is down. Barack Obama has been feared dead. Biden has now confirmed been taken out. He's off the board. So now, of course, the only person left is Speaker of the House, Bernie. Mm. So the pokey evolution has finally been completed in the best way possible. Obama evolved into Biden, and Biden evolved into Bernie, which I hope is a sign of things to come for America. Bernie 2024.
Hell yeah.
So he gets sworn in. He gets the fucking nuclear codes. He's all... some eyebrows are raised, let's just say. We started to have some doubts. The movie starts to focus a little bit on Bernie being sworn in here. There's an interesting part here where he's sworn in and, oh, could I just take a moment? I need to phone my wife.
Yeah.
And so we immediately called it. It's like, oh, okay, who is he really calling?
There was a part at the beginning of the film as well, the first time you were introduced to him. I did almost say, because Kale is having the argument with the squirrel.
Yeah.
There's part of it which says, oh, come on, no, this is a bird feeder. My boss doesn't like squirrels, you have to go. And I was going to say, he's in on it. Whoever this boss is, he's in on it.
Yeah, he hates squirrels.
Who hates squirrels? Yeah. Only evil people.
Only evil people.
Evil people hate squirrels.
Yep, it's so true.
It's true.
Yeah, so the evidence mounts against Bernie. Was this the plan all along?
It's the fucking Bernie bros again.
Yeah, it's the misogynist Bernie bros. If not for them, Hillary would have won. Yeah. And we'd all be at brunch now.
Yeah.
So thanks, guys. Yeah. So Bernie gets sworn in. He has this strange phone call. He comes out and bang, he does a fucking heel turn on the spot.
It was me!
So suddenly he decides that, no, we don't need to talk it out. We don't peacefully stop. It's something he's been advocating the whole time. Yeah. Now we need to fucking full airstrike the White House. We need to level the whole fucking place. He wants to bomb the whole fucking thing.
He basically just comes out and chair shots Lance Reddick.
Yeah. And so Maggie Gyllenhaal's like, what? What the hell are you doing? What the hell's going on? And he's like, listen, I'm sorry, but we need to end this now. We need to end this now. He's still playing babyface. We know what's going on.
It's persuasive.
Flatten
the White House and all them little kids that are in shock. Yeah. And I was like, do you know what? He's got mother.
Yeah, at this point, obviously, like I say, she's double hostaged, and they take her to the Oval Office, and Woods starts speaking over the, like, speaker system, and he's like, we've got a gun to her head, and we're going to kill her, and, you know, here she is crying, and then they do the whole John McClane's wife thing.
Yeah.
The president hears this announcement too. Kale is literally, he's coming out, he's about to turn himself in, and the president, like, jumps out in front of him, and he's like, no, I'm gonna get... So they grab the president, he's like, no, damn it, my president, my country, I love my country. And so, basically, Kale is now still free. The president's been captured. He gets brought to the Oval Office. Kale's daughter is in there. She's all like, oh, don't hurt the president. I love the president. I love my country. So Woods then basically reveals what his plan is to the chagrin of some of the mercenaries. They finally realise what's really going on because they thought they were just in here for money, that they were going to get a ton of cash and then they were going to get away somehow. No actual exit strategy is explained because there cannot be one.
Yeah.
So Woods reveals he needs the president alive because he needs his palm print to unlock the scanner that will open the nuclear football, which is the suitcase that is always within 10 feet of the president. It's like literally chained to some guard.
Yeah.
And inside it is basically the nuclear launch code.
It's kind of the big red button.
Yeah, it's exactly.
That's what it actually is.
Yeah.
Like.
So he's got the football and he's got Obama and he's like, you are gonna fucking launch these nukes. And obviously up to this point we have obviously assumed that the problem that James Woods' character has is that he ordered troops into the Middle East and his son died for nothing. That is the understandable human emotional reasoning behind what he's doing.
Yeah.
And this is one of the reveals where it's like that West Wing liberalism comes out again. We know that this movie thinks that right wing pundits who spread lies and bigotry on television are actually good guys and we're together actually united in grief and pain when our president is under attack, when our values are under attack. But the extremists who don't like the war in the Middle East, well actually what they want is to launch the full nuclear arsenal against the Middle East.
It's the entirety of the Middle East.
To create a forever war and he wants to like wipe out the Middle East, and he's like full war hawk, loves death and wants everyone to die. It's really strange.
Well, he says that he's basically like, oh, it's us or them.
Yeah.
I wish that the pen were mightier than the sword, but yeah, it just isn't.
Yeah, his whole thing is that he wants nuclear Armageddon to just destroy, I mean, everything, really.
Yeah, that's the thing. Launching all of those fucking nukes yeah, on the Middle East would kill everything.
It would kill everything. Yeah. Like, he's, like, completely mask off insane Bond villain at this point, where he just literally wants to destroy the world.
Which is perfect for James Woods.
Oh, it makes the movie that much more insane, and therefore that much better. Yeah. He's got a gun to Kale's daughter's head. He's going to blow her fucking brains out. This other mercenary's there, he's just like, what the fuck is going on? Like, I want some fucking cash. I don't want to nuke anybody.
I don't
want
to nuke the Middle East. What the fuck are you talking about?
So the president just flat out refuses. He's not going to do it. And then it's revealed a bunch of fucking fire alarms start going off and sprinklers start going off. Kale is seen on CCTV in some of the funniest shots, just fucking running around like White House bedrooms, just fucking with a flaming torch, just burning everything. What an image! Oh my god!
Yes!
Bernie's running around.
I'll tell you what, if you only watch one fucking like clip from this film, make it that one, because it's beautiful.
It's so funny.
I also, just before it happens as well, where James Woods has got the gun to the girl's head. I don't know if I've ever seen this in a film, but particularly when it's directed to a child. The president, who's been told, if you launch him, and I'm not saying he should launch him,
they labour the point so much that it's like,
he says, you know, you put your fucking hand to that scanner or I'm going to shoot her in the fucking head. This child who idolises you and you've already met and you know her, you know. He looks to her and he's like, you understand why I can't let him launch it, however many minutes. He literally just said, you understand why I have to let him kill you. I have to let him kill you right now. I can't do anything to try to stop him. And she's like, I understand.
God bless
It's fucking amazing.
So
what a scene.
Yeah. But it's really weird because obviously like the politics of the scene are so at odds. It doesn't make any sense because it's like the whole point is like one life against many. So it's like the lives of the soldiers being sent and the many that would die and blah blah blah. So he's like, he doesn't care. James Woods actually doesn't care that his son died. It's really weird, the reveal that it's like, well, he actually basically doesn't care that his son died, insofar as he's not sad that he died. He's sad that they didn't, like, wipe them all out.
And the war isn't
still going on.
He's sad that the war that killed his son ended.
Yeah.
I wish I had 20 more sons to be killed.
I can kill them all myself. It's really fucking weird. It's kind of funny that at no point, because we find out, I think it's Maggie Gyllenhaal that says it, he has a golf ball-sized tumour in his frontal lobe, and at no point does anyone go, oh, that's why he's doing this. He's gone mad.
He's gone fucking
He's got a brain tumour and he's gone mad. Yeah, so in amongst all of this sort of weirdness, Kale, like, comes charging out. He's trying to free the hostages. He starts fucking stabbing the fuck out of a bunch of mercenaries. And then he just gets caught fucking dead to rights. Bizarrely, in this movie, the neo-Nazi is, like, the smartest, most, like, self-preservation-minded person. The whole thing is super weird.
Yeah.
Kale, he's got his grenades with him still, cracks one of his grenades out, pulls the pin, throws it at the fucking Nazi.
Right at his feet.
And he just fucking kicks it straight back at him and blows him up with it. Fucking floors Kale with it. Kale is just caught fucking dead to rights. He's got his fucking gun on him. He's about to fucking execute Kale as effortlessly as that. And fucking Greg from Succession fucking beats his head in with some like 16th century fucking German masterwork clock. Fucking smashes his brains out.
Brass fucking or bronze or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. He's obsessed with all the fucking antiques and he fucking smashes his head in.
Fucking bouncing.
It's utterly fucking mental. And then he fucking does a full like 180 and becomes fucking Greg the Barbarian. Yeah. Like scoops up a fucing shotgun and fucking and now Tours he's over. Like it's absolutely bizarre. It's like
beautiful.
Like you say, like the milksop that he was, the ideal.
Yeah.
He turns into
the liberal idea.
Yeah, he turns into this like gun-toting Republican. It's like, well, you know, maybe we need a little bit of each, you know, to balance.
The one thing that would have made that just that little bit better is if he'd have taken his tie off and tied it around his forehead.
In fact, we need a strong Republican tie. And so Greg starts leading all of the hostages out because the airstrike's coming, Kale obviously knows at this point, Maggie Gyllenhaal tells him the airstrike's coming, you need to get out, but he's got to go back for his daughter, he ain't going
anywhere. I mean,
anywhere.
She literally advises him,
run away.
Forget your daughter, fuck your daughter.
Yeah, fuck your daughter.
Do you want to go to Miami?
What?
I'm supposed to go to this work conference in Manhattan on Friday, but it's going to be terrible, and I was thinking maybe Miami instead.
I live with my daughter, so I...
Oh, fuck your daughter.
Like, actually, it's just like, run away, get away. And he's like, no, well, I can't. It's my fucking kid, you weirdo. Why would you say that?
Forget your family. They can stay here. We're all bowling.
Yeah. Kale is, like, on his way to the Oval Office. The Merc leader is on his way to kill Kale. The other Merc that's like, hey, I don't want anything to do this. He's like, fuck this, I'm out of here. Woods fucking blasts him, kills him, starts battering the president. The president's like, no, I'm not doing it. President pulls a fucking pen out. We have a literal pen versus sword moment. Stabs James Woods in the fucking neck with a pen. James Woods starts battering him around with a fucking gun. They're like slinging each other around. The girl's like screaming like, no, stop. He fucking grabs the president's palm, forces it onto the scanner. They fight for a bit longer. James Woods gets the president at gunpoint and the president is like, come on, man. Come on, James Woods. This ain't you. Are you really gonna shoot the president? And he's like, hell yeah, motherfucker! Bang! Just blows the president away.
Come on, this isn't you. You protect the president for the past 25 years. What are you gonna do? You really gonna shoot me? Yes.
Oh my god! Shoots him straight in the chest. President's out for the count. James Woods drags the fucking kid back into the Oval Office and starts setting up the fucking nuclear football to just literally, he's like programming in like all these Middle Eastern nations and cities.
Yeah, it's like all the capital cities are basically every Middle Eastern
he's gonna launch all these. We see like the submarine phone and they're like, oh my god, all the nukes just came. There's like 20 nukes he's about to launch. Like, literally, he's about to kill all life on Earth. While this is all going down, Kale is fighting the leader of the mercenaries. The mercenary guy is just battering the fuck out of him, slinging him around the fucking press room, slinging him about, battering him out because he's killed all his mates. They're both military, so they're like, you know, it's like Kale and Shadow Kale.
He's fighting
off against his evil doppelganger. So he starts battering him. He's going to carve his name in his chest.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going to shoot you between the worlds.
I'm a piss in your eye.
So he's got his knife. Kale then decides to just switch it on right at the last minute. Instantly disarms him, knifes him in the foot, takes his rig off full of grenades, fucking slings it all the way around him, ties it all the way around this fucking guy with the fucking grenades all around his throat. And he's like, oh, you're gonna send me to prison. He's like, bang, pulls all the pins out. No fucking prison for you, bitch. Boots him down, blows this fucking guy in
the face. I love as well, he takes cover from the blast of like these 15 grenades. Behind the fucking lectern.
A wooden lectern and it just somehow weathers
them. Fine. It
can survive a nuclear blast. He goes off, he's outside, he can see into the Oval Office, he can see his daughter hiding against the window. She's like, oh no, James Woods is fucking programming the nuclear football. He's literally just like, I just need to press my fucking thumb down on the big red button and bang, the fucking nukes are flying. Hallelujah! Nukes are in the air. Hallelujah.
This is not necessary, Mr. President. We have a diplomatic solution.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Secretary, the missiles are flying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And so Kale is like looking over and he looks over and he sees one of the big SUVs. James Woods is sat there and he's like, hallelujah moment. Yes, I'm about to fucking destroy the planet. I love God and freedom, the Pledge of Allegiance. Nuke everybody.
Could you give us some of your political beliefs?
Kill everyone now. Condone first degree murder. Advocate cannibalism. Eat shit.
And he's about to fucking press the big red button. Kale comes smashing through the fucking window of the Oval Office. Bangs into the fucking presidential desk. Smashes into James Woods. And fucking splatters him against the wall.
It's honestly the scene. It's literally, it's Die Hard meets the Terminator. Yeah. And it's glorious.
It's so good. He's like, like crushed against the wall, laying on the bonnet with the fucking nuclear football on the bonnet with him.
Yeah. And he's still reaching.
And he's like going for it like that. And she's like, Dad, he's got the fucking Merc this motherfucker. Yeah, finish him off. Double tap. Do the motherfucker in the brain. He comes fucking jumping out of the fucking sunroof with a fucking minigun. And he fucking point blanks James Woods to fucking pieces with a minigun.
It's honestly,
it's incredible.
Oh my god!
Everybody get down! Get down!
Oh my god! Motherfucking no!
Yes! Oh. Oh my god!
Oh fuck yeah!
That was beautiful. The only weapon known to man that can take down a crazed James Woods.
It's one of the best villain deaths an action film I've seen for fucking years.
I was so worried that he was going to have this really shitty letdown death.
Yeah.
Or that, like,
or they just arrested him.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah. And it was like, I was waiting for him to have another one of these weird turns, you know, when he earlier on.
Yeah.
And he needed to take the pills and that. I thought, like.
Oh, he was, just before
And he's like, oh, falls over. And then they come in and they're like, this man needs help, he's sick and ill, and he's just mad. And he's like, oh no, what did I do? I'm so wrong and evil and bad.
But let's give him just a present. Like,
but instead he's just like, blood of me. And he died doing what he loved. He got, attempting nuclear Armageddon of the world's entire population.
He got ripped to utter fucking ribbons by like fucking 50 cal rounds.
Yeah, by like 100 fucking rounds of it. It was absolutely fantastic. So yeah, Kale is reunited with his daughter and he's like, you gotta get out of here, we've got like a minute left, the fucking airstrike's still coming, you gotta go. And she's like, the president's dead, he killed the president. And he's like, oh my god, I need to get the president, I need to make sure, you need to run. And he pushes her out and he's like, you have to go, leave me behind. And she starts like running out onto the lawn of the White House. The fucking jets are swooping.
Yeah, they're literally
everybody's like just watching him coming. Greg has got out and he's like, bumps into the mum and she's like, what's going on. He's like, there's an airstrike, we need to go. And she's like, but my daughter's still in there. And people will start running back, people are trying to get back into the White House to save the people that are left. They're all running, it's chaos, the planes are all barreling down. He comes running in and finds the president fucking laid out dead on the floor and he's like, oh my god, I failed my country, I failed my president, what have I done? And so the daughter comes running out and she scoops up like this old fucking like revolutionary fucking American flag.
It's like the presidential
seal from the fucking Oval Office.
The blue with the eagle and that. Like.
And she comes out and she does her fucking flag twirling routine. To wave off the fucking edge.
Of all the setups that pay off that one. It was her flag twirling.
I didn't realise.
I didn't think until afterwards.
I thought it was just fucking Nicolas Cage from The Rock with the fucking flares. And they're fucking barreling down to fucking airstrike the fucking White House. And she's on the lawn like, fucking through the flag. All the people on the White House are all like screaming up at the fucking pilot. Kale's looking in the fucking TVs in the room. He can see his daughter fucking doing it. He's like, yes, we love our cops. Our law. We love our military. They are important. And we get possibly the most outrageous thing I've ever seen in one of these types of movies. The fucking Air Force pilot is swooping down.
The squadron leader.
Yeah, and they're coming in and he's like, oh my god, there are civilians down here. There's a little kid.
Waving a flag.
Yeah, and Bernie's like, you know, full mask up. And he's like, kill all of the children. He's like Palpatine.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's got lightning shooting out of his fingers. And the guy's like, no, I disobey a direct order from my commander-in-chief. How dare you order me to strike on civilians from the air with a missile? I would never do such a thing, and Americans don't stand for such outrageous violations of international law. Yeah. How dare you? I'm calling off this airstrike. And they all...
I can't do it, guys. Yeah. I'm not going to do it, guys.
Pulls the mask off.
I'm not going to do
revealing the human face beneath the mask.
I'm not going to do it, boys. This child is white.
They fucking go swooping off everyone's cheer, and he comes out, and she's like, hey, did you see my flag routine? The fucking president sits up. The president's fine. They're like, oh,
he does an undertaker.
Yeah. He fucking tombstones James Woods into a fucking grave and they bury him alive.
Abort mission pod! Abort! Abort! Abort!
No!
He was so patriotic and he loved his country so much he brought the president back to life. So he comes out and he's like, oh my god, pulls the fucking Lincoln watch out that he put away just for this moment.
Another Roland Emmerich fucking classic bullet stuck in the watch.
And he's like, oh, old Abe took two bullets for me. And they're like, ha ha, slapping each other on the back. It's so funny. That we see, like, they're all cheering in the bunker, like Lance Reddick's fucking pulling his... Everyone's cheering except for Bernie. And we know at this point, oh, he wanted the airstrike, he was pushing for this airstrike. Early on we saw James Woods, like, he gets a pager,
this is the pager,
and he writes down like launch codes, and it's like, oh, this motherfucker. Well, there's only one person right now that has the launch codes, that's the guy that just got sworn in as president. If ain't the fucking vice president, he got fucking on the force one.
No one ever finds out, and he just has to pretend for the rest of his life.
And we see Maggie Gyllenhaal, she gets, like, Matt Gaetz comes up and he's like, hey, I looked into that thing you wanted me to check into. I've got some shocking news. Her hands over and they're like, ah. And over the shoulder you see Bernie and he's like, ah. And so we come back to the White House and, like, fucking Channing Tatum and fucking all the other, Kale and the President and all that, and they're like, they're on the phone, they're like, hey, that's some damn good shooting text. And, or some bollocks, you know. And, like, she's like, look, I've got some intel that James Woods didn't do this alone. Someone was involved, someone from DC.
Yeah, well, she's saying it's like, because we were looking into how did he get in touch with all of these people. Yeah. Like, well, he didn't. It was someone else.
But he seems to figure it out, and he's like, Mr. President, I think I know who did this, and I need you to help me unmask the traitor in our midst. And he's like, John, you're my blood brother and Shadow Wolf. I'd gladly take a bullet for you, babe. And they fucking, like, it's like Dutch and fucking Dylan.
Yeah,
fucking,
yeah, yeah,
son of a bitch. Basically, Kale comes out with his daughter. They come stumbling out. Lance Reddick's there, and Maggie Gyllenhaal's there, and Bernie's there, and they're like, God damn, you did a fine job. Like, you saved this country, you saved the world from nuclear annihilation. The president's not there, and Bernie's like, where's the president? And he's like, he didn't make it. He's dead. And we know that that's not true. And then he's like, damn, that's such a shame. Right.
I'll have to address the nation.
I need to address the nation. Blah, blah, blah. Do this, do that, do this. Starts making all these sudden professional... He ain't flustered anymore.
Starts making
all these big decisions. He's like, we need to start putting troops back into the
Middle East. Yeah,
we're not pulling out of the Middle East. We need to go straight back. And then Maggie Gyllenhaal's like, what are you talking about? We can't do that. And he's like, they're going to see this as weakness. And once they find out...
Yeah, well, we just, like, tried to fucking nuke them.
They're going
to
go crazy. We need as many troops in there as we can get. And they're like, oh my God, what the hell is going on? And then Kale pulls the rug out from him. He's like, why don't you tell me when you turn traitor, you goddamn son of a bitch? And he's like, what the hell are you talking about, John? John's like, God damn, you sold out the greatest nation on earth. So he's got the pager from Wood's body.
Yeah.
And he's like, ha ha, see? Only one person uses a pager and had those codes at the same time. It must be you, you old crotchety communist son of a bitch. And he's like, oh my God, are you ridiculous? Two old guys using You can't prove anything. You fool, you buffoon, you big dullard, you idiot. I took you in and gave you this job out of sympathy because you're so stupid. And now I'm going to ruin you.
In the way you said, I gave you this job out of pity. And this is how you repay me. So what, for pity?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, cheers.
I gave you this job because I think you're a cunt.
Now you're throwing dad, bang him back. So yeah, so he's basically like, I'm the president that saved the day. Your guy is dead. He nearly launched those nukes. He opened the football for him. How do you think that's gonna play? Yeah, you stick by him, you go down with him. Bang! Dramatic reveal. Ha ha! The president emerges in his Jordans and he's like, say what, motherfucker? And he's like, oh my god, the president's dead. And then Kale's like, this is the fucking number that it came from. Hey, Maggie Gyllenhaal, why don't you call that fucking number back? Boom, throws her the page. She's like, starts playing fucking Spanish flea, caught fucking red-handed, you fucking dirty bastard. Bernie Sanders at it again. Lock him up. Lock him up. Lock him up. So yeah, Bernie does like a Jeffrey Archer and he blows it right at the last minute. And Lance Reddick, with pleasure, he fucking arrests Bernie, and the president is back. God damn, it's good to have you back, sir. Yeah, so basically, the fucking helicopter comes down. The president's like, hey, I need my number one security guy. Get your ass in here, big boy.
Fuck your family.
Yeah, they start, like, tongue-kissing, and he's got, like, his hand in the back of his trousers. And then Kale turns around, and he's like, points to his door, and he's like, hey, how'd you fancy a ride? And she's like, oh, yeah, I love the presidency.
She's like, fuck you, mum. Pushes her mum away.
Literally just completely leaves the mum behind. They all go on.
Yeah, fuck all the trauma I've experienced today. Let's go for a helicopter ride. Yeah,
the mum just left there with Greg from Succession.
coming on to him.
She's like, yeah, okay, thanks, mate. And then they fly off, and it's fucking brilliant. You'll never guess what happens, Joe. You'll never guess what happens.
Will I not guess what happens?
They're flying over the White House, and hey, the president wants to do the thing. Ah, they fucking swoop down over it, and she's like, yeah, the president's just, America's so good and cool, actually. And then the fucking thing, but credits roll, fucking Rolling Stones start playing. Fucking what's the actual
I have no
fuck?
Idea what
that was like, so fucking weird. Fucking Street Fighting
Man. Yeah.
And it's like, what the fuck?
Like,
what?
How is that? Like, okay, I guess, like, in a very broad sense, I can see how that fits.
There is a man who does some fighting.
There's some
in the movie.
Yeah, there are. There are men who fight.
And also there are streets.
And
it just feels so inappropriate.
Yeah, it made no sense as the end credits theme.
It was brilliant.
It was perfect, yeah.
So there we have it. That's White House Down.
That is White House Down.
White House Down.
Down, yeah.
It was absolutely fantastic.
It was
so much more than I ever had hoped for. Like I say, I have really vague memories of having watched it, but I feel like surely I would have remembered that. I must have just watched Olympus Has Fallen twice by the time. It was fantastic.
Yeah.
It's so worth a watch.
Yeah.
Like, just sit with some friends.
Yeah. On your own, probably be funny, but I would suggest watching this film with company. Have a drink and enjoy yourself.
Yeah, it's very funny. Great cast. It's all well shot. Jarring, like, weird. Terrible like, shit like
it's
that.
It's one of those things, again, Roland Emmerich, isn't it? It's very competently made. It's like, you're never going to sit there and say, oh, wow, look at the cinematography in this scene.
Exactly.
Or, oh,
nothing
that shot.
Jumps
this,
out.
There's nothing overly artistic about it. But it's
but that's fine
very for, competent. For, it's what it needs to be. You know, everything that needs to be there is there.
Yeah, everything, by and large, makes sense. There's some
pretty
kind
much,
of weird cul-de-sacs that just don't go anywhere for some reason.
But
overall, like I say, it's kind of a testament to just how dumb and hilarious this movie is. But despite all of that, it is still like a solid 10 out of 10 experience.
I was expecting, you know, a big, dumb action movie, and I wasn't disappointed. Mm. There are plenty of big, dumb action movies that you watch, and they're fine, and you completely forget about them within 20 minutes of watching them. This, wow! I mean,
This was a classic.
This is up there with like Seagal movies and stuff like that.
It's as entertaining as like Out for Justice.
Shouting at the screen, I was cheering, I was often confused.
Yes.
It's everything you want from a cinematic experience.
I laughed, I cried, I stood up and shouted, I yelled at the screen.
I shat myself.
I cheered, I shouted, I fist pumped the air. I cried. It's absolutely everything that you hoped it was going to be.
It was brilliant. Yeah, 10 out of 10. Do watch it. Watch it with friends. Honestly, like,
it's hilarious.
It's fucking
it's really
funny.
Funny.
It was stupid. It was kind of senseless. But it was, ultimately a hell of a lot of fun. And that's kind of all you can really ask from a film like this, you know? In terms of its politics, like, I mean, obviously this is why we're here at the end of the day. Again, in the end, I don't think the people making this have, like, a particularly firmly held political ideology.
Yeah.
Because it was so all over the place.
Part of the problem.
Yeah, it wasn't, like...
So muddled. And yeah. All it really had to say was, shouldn't we all just come together and... Hey, I don't know, aren't good things good and bad things bad?
I mean, it was very much a sort of a liberal fucking parable.
Yeah. Moderates are good.
Yeah.
Anyone who wants to change things is secretly an extremist lunatic who wants to kill
everyone. So, yeah, in that regard, I can definitely attack its politics. Mm.
But that's part of what makes the experience so hilarious.
Yeah.
Is because it's so politically inept and fucking ignorant that when you then couple it with, like, the president leaning out of the fucking limo with a fucking chrome RPG, it's like, what the hell is even happening?
You can't hold the politics of the movie against it because it's so stupid in every regard. Yes. But, well, of course it's politically fucking illiterate, isn't it?
It's got dumb politics. It has to.
It was fantastic. It's an absolute fucking glorious mess.
Yeah.
10 out of 10, go watch it.
Yeah.
Wow.
What a movie.
Incredible. Here's to you, Mr. Emmerich. Mm-hmm. That was a fucking belter.
I
think I loved that.
That was amazing.
That was truly, truly amazing. Yeah, so I think that's really all we've got to say. It was a joy to watch. Mm. Really enjoyed it. Yeah.
Which is a first here on Blind Drunk.
I don't know, I really, really liked Cats.
No one really liked Cats.
I think we enjoyed Rudy. We kind of
I've got to be honest, I mean, even Cats to a degree I enjoyed just because it was mad and it was fun to do this with it, you know. But in terms of just full on, like, actually enjoying the film, to the point where I would watch it again. Like I say, in exactly the same way as I like Seagal films and stuff.
Yes,
It's so bad that it's good.
Yes, it's genuinely
really
just that.
It really is. Yeah. It's,
At this point, I find it really hard to see how Olympus Has Fallen could possibly be as good as that.
I can't see it topping that. This was a genuine schlock banger. You know what I mean? Like,
the only difference is that Olympus Has Fallen features the North Koreans invading the White House.
That is
something I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, we'll have to get on with that. We'll have to watch that pretty soon.
So, yeah, White House down, 10 out of 10. Olympus Has Fallen. We're coming for you.
Thanks to everyone for watching. Yeah. Thank you for all of your donations on Patreon, everyone who subscribes to our YouTube channel, everyone who's watched or commented on any of our videos. Thank you all very, very much. And we will endeavour to keep this up as long as we can.
Yeah. If you liked the video, give it a like. Leave a comment if you've got anything to say. If you have any suggestions for videos you want us to
We always love reading your guys' comments. So, yeah, if anyone has any suggestions, we are always more than happy to read them.
Anything with James Woods.
Particularly anything
with
James
Woods. I mean, it would be a 10 out of 10.
Yeah. Candid footage of James Woods.
Holiday snaps.
Oh, yeah, just him on the bus.
Yeah, pissing himself in the supermarket aisle.
Without your suggestions, we would never have watched Cats.
Yeah, God.
Could you imagine if we'd never have watched
that? I don't want to live in that kind of world. So, yeah, thanks for all your support. Thanks for watching.
Thank you very much.
And make sure to tune in next time when we'll basically be watching this movie all over again.
Cheers.
Well, folks, we're finally getting nicked.